don't know where I first, like, he was, Michael's just kind of an enigma, you know, it's like he's just kind of always been there.
It was our third show, and again, it was me playing a drum and a cymbal, and Michael playing guitar, and Jack playing bass.
He's a little too older for me. He's still a little too older for me. No, I'm just kidding. Andy used to work at the record store. I was a patron.
Awful lot on the phone at that point. And he just said, man, I'm just writing these songs like crazy, you know. And these were all winners. Every one, just kept bringing them in. It was like boom, boom, boom. And the next thing you know, you've got this great record, or what I think is a great record. So.
So the first kind of run-in I had with them, kind of in that incarnation, was them yelling at me for playing the record before I was supposed to play the record. You know, I
can't believe you would play our song.
Yeah, I can't believe you would play this record. I mean, I haven't even shipped it to college radio. I mean, of course, I've just gone down to school kids and bought it.
And it's just the whole climate's changed. It's so easy now with you know, the internet and, you know, iTunes, you know, downloadable song. You know, you can, it doesn't mean you're going to be on the cover of Rolling Stone. But you can impose on the world. It's never been easier to impose on the world with your bullshit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He called me and left me a message, and I thought he was going to ask me about, you know, something business-oriented, like a record company or a manager or something like that. So I called him back and asked me if I would do it. And I was in complete shock.
So we had to borrow a guitar amp from somebody to run our vocals through. So we hooked the mic up to a guitar amp to do the vocals. And then my snare drum was, he didn't put a mic on the snare drum, but the club owner who used to babysit for me said it was too loud. So we put a towel over it.
That's what it was.
And I was playing with a towel over my snare drum, and it was still too loud. And so I had to keep, and plus when I hit it, the towel would fall off in the middle of the song.
Starting a recurring pattern for years.
That's what I remember. It was a pretty rocking show. It was a pretty good show. And then Michael and I always loved it because at the end of the gig, like, we were, like, sweating and everything, and we, Michael and I, went up the stairs out of the cave up to the street, and there was this old Chinese man was sitting up there, and he'd seen the show, and he was smoking a cigarette. Michael and I came out dressed, and he was like, "Hot, number one!" Michael and I was, like, the ultimate compliment.
Yeah.
How do you define success in Snatches of Pink?
I guess making good records and playing good shows. Nothing more than that.
You know? So back in 1990, you opened up for the Ramones.
Yeah. At the Fillmore.
Yeah.
So like, I'm the kind of dumbass where, you know, some people drink a lot and they don't get hangovers, and then some people drink and they get hangovers and they don't drink anymore. Like, I'm like learning impaired when it comes to drinking. Like, I'm the dumbass who drinks and gets that death hangover but never learns. Just, you know, I'm that guy. And then I remember some point towards the end, man, I started really having equilibrium issues, and I just took a dive. I just remember going down.
Total, you know, rock and roll. Just rock and roll the way rock and roll always was.
Good. We went through different eras, you know, because we were together a long time, and then we sort of kind of grew up together, and in some ways, and then in other ways, didn't grow up together.
Chosen not to.
Yeah, well, you know, but we were friends for life, so that's. I really think that's one of the reasons why we stuck together.
He seems like a person that really knew what he wanted to hear, and so he did what he wanted to hear.
He wants to be appreciated for where he and the band are at now. That's what's important.
I won't be held back because someone doesn't want to give me a record deal. It's the only thing I know how to do. You know, it's a lot of worse gigs out in the world. You know, so I guess as long as I keep writing songs that I don't think suck, I imagine there'll be a couple